right. The silence, come on, we need some energy. Okay, 23 days till spring. Okay, so I'm just trying to warm you up because you're going to have a fantastic afternoon. So we want to demonstrate some energy, some enthusiasm. We're Changeology. You're going to leave here, your life's going to be changed. So listen intently. Take notes copiously. It's my pleasure, all kidding aside, it is my delight and my pleasure to be here this afternoon with all of you and to introduce Professor Neufeld, who is very excited about today. I can remember being a new president in the fall, Dr. Neufeld coming to my office and saying, we've got this great idea to have Dr. Norcross come and talk to our students. And I listened intently, and then came, and I'll be able to do it. And I said, absolutely. And so Dr. Neufeld, Professor Kukmas are here today, along with Mr. Chris Otier. And Chris is from Dime Bank. And I just want to let all of you know that Dime Bank is an underwriter for the Booker DeMond series. And without further ado, I will introduce Chris, who will share some words from Dime Bank for us.
Thank you. Very briefly, so Booker DeVaughn was the president of this college, I believe, from 1992 to 2000. And subsequent to that, in 2007, they established this endowment for the purpose of writing this lecture series. Dime Bank contributed $25,000 to that initial fundraiser to get this thing started. And it's nice that from then to today, a number of other donations have come in, so it's now essentially a six-figure endowment, which allows the school every year to bring in speakers like Dr. Norcross and a number of other ones over the last few years. And it's been a nice benefit to the school, and we're proud to be a part of that. So that's about all I have to say for it. Thank you for letting us be part of this, and we appreciate you coming out for this event. So thank you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming. Welcome. I love familiar faces. Good to see. And very pleased, very excited to have Professor Norcross coming to campus. My name is Steve Neufeld. I'm a sociology professor here on campus. I'm also the chair of the Learning Across the Board Committee, which is organizes our annual theme, which we have to work on publicizing more. Our theme is sustainability. Which we've had last year and this year, and that's partly where this whole idea of behavioral change ties in, to try to make behavioral changes and sustain them. So we did an event last year, which we're doing again this year, the Smart Change Challenge, where people pledge to make behavioral changes, and we are taking pledges. We did it today, and we'll be doing it again tomorrow, and then we'll have a reception in a few weeks. Anyway, that's probably why we brought Professor Norcross, asked him to come today, and we're very happy to have him. And I want to thank President Joukowsky for helping, for supporting this, and we did kind of pounce on this thing pretty much to go over. And I want to thank Chris and Dime Bank very much for sponsoring this. Professor Norcross is a highly acclaimed scholar. And on his website, it also says the undisputed authority on New Year's resolutions. I don't know if he wrote that or somebody wrote it for him. But he's a leading scholar on the subject of behavioral change. I could go on. He's written numerous books about it, dating back. I did his graduate work at the University of Rhode Island. He's now a distinguished professor of psychology at the University of Scranton. He's written numerous books that have multiple editions, hundreds of articles. His most recent book is the book Changeology, which he's going to be talking about today, which he's written actually for a popular audience. So he's very good at speaking to lay people and getting out of the ivory tower. We're very fortunate to have him here today to talk about his book. So he's going to open, just giving a little introduction, explanation book, and then basically we're just going to have an open question and answer period. And I have some questions, but I hope most of you will do so as well. So without any further ado, please welcome Professor John Norcross. Thank you.
Thank you for that warm welcome, President, and I love to be supported by banks. That's a great place to be. And you're now the popular audience, so welcome. So what's a smart change about? It's actually an acronym, S-N-A-R-T, and it's widely used, so I incorporated it into the book. When you are setting goals, you want to be smart. S is for specific, N is for, someone's going to have to help me out, measurable. If it's not measurable, it doesn't work. The famed management consultant, Peter Drucker, says, what is measured improves. It's an old but well-established principle. Specific, measurable, attainable. I can't tell you how many people come up to me with their resolutions and goals, and it's to write the great American novel. How about writing two chapters? Forget about that it's going to be the great American novel. Let's see, S-M-A-R, realistic. And by the way, realistic means it's realistic about you, not trying to control other people's behaviors. We don't even let that pass as a goal. And then timely, what is your time certain frame? By the way, in Changeology, it's 90 days. Why 90 days? Because both neuroscience and behavioral science tells us it takes at least 90 minutes to convert from a problem to a sustainable behavior. Now, my publisher has been trying for years saying, well, can't you just make that shorter? So I said, sure, we'll say 3 months instead of 90 days. Because three sounds much better than 90, after all. The truth is, if anyone tells you they can get you there sooner, they're just lying to you. It takes 90 days, I'm sorry. I know it would be more popular to say, guaranteed in 5 days. That's just not how we're made, friends. There's no research supporting that. You may be able to make the change for 5 days, but unless you sustain it for several months, then you're just going to relapse time and time again. Now why am I, and no I didn't write that, Steve, but why am I the undisputed authority on New Year's resolutions? Excellent question. Because there are 5 studies in the scientific literature on resolutions. We've done 3 of them. One was done in Europe, and one was done by a friend, Al Marlott, who died last year. So if you think about it, who else are they going to call? Someone that we can't find in Europe, the dead guy, or Norcross. So that's why I am the undisputed authority. And sad for my family, I do at least 100 interviews every December. In fact, for the large magazines, they begin calling in September because they need to plan the articles. So you may have seen me because even the national morning television shows don't have anyone else to call. So, if any of you are looking for a complicated longitudinal study, please do it on New Year's resolutions, and you can do all my media appearances during the holiday season when I'm supposed to be relaxing with my family. They're really quite annoying. And now that my kids are old and grown up, they don't like going into New York on December 31st to appear on the 1st on the Today Show or Good Morning America. It used to be a kick. When they were 8 or 9, but I don't care if they send the limousine or not. I'm just tired of going in. Okay. So you do the research, and you next year can be the undisputed authority on New Year's resolutions. So sadly, that is true. So I've been asked to start with the most frequent questions I'm asked. And maybe that will warm you and prompt you to begin asking all these insightful questions. So the first one that everyone asks, all right, so why'd you write the book? Changeology, 5 steps to realizing your goals and resolutions. Well, here it is. Not a day passes in my professional life as a university professor, as a clinical psychologist, as the undisputed authority of New Year's resolutions, when I'm not asked by someone or a media outlet, how do people change? And think about that for a moment. Most of you have never been systematically trained in behavior change. Okay? Instead, how do you learn? Oprah, Dr. Phil, watching your parents, learning bad ways of going about it. Or, if you're in psychology, maybe you've learned how to help other people change but rarely are methods and principles from psychotherapy brought to bear on ourselves, which we call self-change. Others, I should acknowledge the one big exception to that. We mental health professionals love to diagnose one another. But with that exception, we really don't apply the research to ourselves. So after years of people saying, I want to change, I tried to change, I failed so many times, I'm disillusioned, I'm demoralized, I don't know how, we literally wrote this book. And if you come this evening, you'll see this has occurred over 32 years, including with my colleagues, Jim Prochaska and Carlo Di Clementi. We've been doing this now for exactly 31.8 years with the generous funding of the National Institutes of Health to the tune of a total of $100 million. So we do know how people change. We followed people over 10 to 20 years about how they've changed, what they use, what they don't use. Now, in fairness, the other question is, how did you discover what worked? Well, that's a fabulous question, and when I hope you all get to read this, between semesters, of course. Read your textbooks first, read the second. People told us. So some of our early studies, we went out and asked successful changers, how did you succeed, finally, to change that behavior? Be it smoking, depression, alcohol, relationships, stop biting your nails, sleeping without the lights on. This method of the steps or stages of change have now been applied in over 50 behavioral difficulties. And you know what they told us? They said, well, it depends when you're talking about. And to that date, virtually no one was talking about the stages of change. Everybody was just saying, well, this works or that works. But successful changers knew it all depended upon when they were changing. Well, what worked for me when I didn't think I had a problem was very different from when I did think I had a problem. And when I first thought I had a problem, then it took a while to actually change the behavior. And then, you know, that was different from when I tried to maintain the problem behavior. So that's the first great secret. It is when people change. They go through a series of steps. First, they deny there's a problem. We call that pre-contemplation. And I was telling Steve here, our first self-help book about 20 years ago, we spent one quarter of the book on pre-contemplation. That is, it's denial, essentially. People deny that they have a problem. They're unaware, consciously or unconsciously. They're not ready to talk about it as a problem. Well, guess what? People who deny there's a problem don't buy self-help books. Doesn't that sound so obvious? I can't believe how stupid we were. So in this book, we don't talk about people in denial. We begin in the next step. But just for future reference, there is a whole stage where people are just in denial. After denial, they need psych. That's the step. So there's pre-contemplation. We don't use the word denial. Then there's psych, in which people are literally psyching themselves up, getting motivated, getting ready. Then there's a prep. Prep, short for preparation. They're preparing what specifically to do. You don't want to jump out of the airplane and sew the parachute on the way down. And yet, that's what lots of people do when it comes to changing. They say, I want to change. I'll find out how I do after I start. That is just an awful way of changing. So pre-contemplation. Then we have psych, getting motivated, preparation, and then guess what? Sooner or later, you need to perspire. That's literally when you begin to take action. You're doing something about it. But notice, the change cycle began earlier, just not with the action or perspire stage. Then once you start working at it and your behavior begins to gradually alter and improve, then you need to keep it going. And in order to keep it going, that means you have to avoid the inevitable slips. We psychologists call these lapses or relapses in the behavior. Right? So let's say you were saying, I'm going to exercise at least four times a week. Well, you start off great for 2 or 3 weeks, and then you say, geez, this is way too cold and way too much snow to exercise this week. So you just suffered a lapse. You want to ensure that single lapse does not culminate in a total relapse. So a lapse is a singular unwanted return of the behavior. Relapse, of course, is the whole fall. So as we say, don't let a slip become a fall. Even if you get through that, you then need to persist. Because it's not enough to just change your behavior. So that is the fifth and final P. We psych, we prep, we perspire, we persevere through the slips, and then long term we need to persist. Five P's. And if you have pre-contemplation, I'm not talking about it in this book, there's actually a six, which would be pre-contemplation. That's the secret, and in truth, I would like to tell you that Jim Prochaska and I discovered this on our own. The truth is, successful changers led us on that path. Well, what is the secret? Well, the secret is not simply that there's steps of change. I mean, we could have done that with, I'm sure, just a couple $1 million of federal research funding in maybe 5 or 6 years. That was the easy part. But you will recall when we said, how did you successfully change? The self-changer said, it depends on when you're talking about. That's the steps of change. So the secret sauce is doing the right thing at the right stage. That is the secret. Once you know which step you're in, we can tell you scientifically what will help you progress the best. Literally millions of Americans mismatch their steps. And some of these are really quite heartbreaking. You know, since you write the book, everyone can easily find you using Google. I get at least 4 or 5 emails a week that go something like this. Dear doctor, thank you for your inspiring or interesting book. You know, 1 out of 10 just says, I don't understand your book, but the rest of the people seem to get it fairly well. Then they say, this put everything into perspective. I've been trying to change X for the last 30 years of my life. I now understand that I use things that get me motivated, that get me emotionally aroused, and that only takes me so far. Soon, the buzz wears off, and within 7 days, I fail miserably. That's step matching. Why? Because the experiential processes of becoming more aware, getting emotional, reevaluating your life, that takes you through psych and prep, right? That gets you ready for change. But those exact same change strategies predict failure once you're into action stage, into perspire, persist, and persevere. So what works for the early stages leads to failure in the later stages. And that explains why willpower by itself does not ensure success. In fact, in our studies on resolutions and self-change and even psychotherapy, people using lots of willpower, I can do it, you know, motivation, I just got to keep going. Those people using lots of willpower fail at twice the rate of everybody else. Why? Because willpower gets you only so far, but sooner or later your willpower is going to drop and then you have nothing else to help you. So you need to use multiple change catalysts, which as you start asking questions we can go through. So willpower is necessary, it's helpful. But by itself is a terrible way of going. It's always willpower plus other skills, all of which, of course, are covered in here. So here's the other question I'm frequently asked, and then I'll look forward to you peppering me with questions. So this question is asked, the identical question is asked in 2 ways. The first one is asked defiantly in a challenging way. I love it. Someone will say, so Dr. Norcross, are you successful every time? Or it can be asked sheepishly from the more polite types. So Dr. Norcross, just wondering, are you usually successful? Of course I'm not successful all the time. No one is. All we can do is increase probability. And just looking at me, like most people, consumptory disorders. Right here is the number one obstacle. In truth, however, virtually all other goals in my life have nicely been realized, largely because I do follow the science. Now, P Please don't blame yourselves or other people around you for not knowing how to change. You have never literally been taught. Okay? So get rid of the I should have known, how come I didn't read, and let's face it, most of the self-help out there is pure nonsense. I love science-informed self-help. In fact, for 4 or 5 editions now, we have a book published by Oxford University Press called Self-Help That Works, trying to distinguish the nonsense from the real stuff. So even if you try to find, quote unquote, an expert, most of the stuff out there is, well, I was going to say worthless, but it's worthless or worse, because some self-help actually leads people to fail at a higher rate. Here's an example. How many of you, by show of hands, have heard about the book The Secret? Anybody? Yes, a few of you. Well, it talks about being positive, but it says, if you believe, then you're guaranteed to receive what you're doing. But as it does so, it says, if good things come to you, you've created them. In fact, one of the examples, very sadly in the book, is that if you really want and believe, there will be a parking space. You can mentally create a physical reality of a parking space. Now, I'm sorry to have to disabuse you. You cannot mentally create stuff with your mind. Okay? You can create a positive perspective, and that really works. Moreover, and by the way, I was on the Oprah show debating this until the author, Rhonda Burns, decided she wasn't going to show, leaving us sitting there. So Oprah Winfrey first popularized the book, but then when things came out, people began screaming, this is nonsense, this is not true. You do not physically create a reality. You create a mental set. So we love positive psychology, but we don't believe you can literally, you know, make the lights go off. Yeah. If you think you can, go ahead. Raise my hand. Go ahead. Raise my hand. No, sorry. But now follow the logic. If it's guaranteed, if bad things happen to you, and this is all due to your belief, who's responsible for bad things? Famine, cancer, sexual assault, automobile accidents. You must have brought them on yourself, according to The Secret. So not only are some self-help books worthless, some of them actually hurt people. So back to this up. You have not been trained. If you've looked around, you find a lot of conflicting nonsense. Maybe you walked on hot coals with good old Tony Robbins, which is great motivating. But by the way, that kind of motivation lasts between 10 and 14 days and then entirely evaporates. Okay? And that's not a tool to maintain change anyway. That's a good tool to get you pumped up for beginning a change. But that's the stuff, remember, that predicts failure once you actually change. Because then you run out of the mojo. So no, I'm not successful all the time, but far more than most people. Because I believe in the science. That's what we've done for 30 years, following the successes and secrets of how people actually change. And hence, I know it's a terrible, well, I actually like it, but we've done focus groups. Changeology. Doesn't quite go too well. But I hope you get it. Ology, meaning scientific study of change. That's literally what we need. By the way, if someone's not going to buy or give you the book, just go to our free website and you can download big parts of it, www.changeologybook.com. It's free, you don't have to register, just grab some useful stuff. I much prefer that people use it rather than just making a couple bucks on royalties.
Yeah, perfect. All right.
I can go forever, believe me. Right, just get me started. But I'd much rather chase your energy and interest.
Okay. I just have plenty to go with now. So, you know, just like I said, really just start.
Yeah, I'm a professor, so I can start calling on you randomly.
So please start asking away.
I've got one.
You know, I have to pick in, because the first question gets a book. If I give the free book to the president, it's going to look really swarmy, and you're not going to believe it. But there you go, you get the free book to reward questions. So go ahead, sir.
What's your view on hypnotism and its impact on change?
Yeah, hypnosis. Most clinical psychologists, including me, have learned hypnosis and we use it. There's nothing really magical about this. You are at a suggestible state. You let down your defenses. And for people who are comfortable with it, it has a mild positive effect in addition to everyone else. But people believing they can just use hypnosis and nothing else to lose weight and stop smoking, none of that's true. But if you do tools for that, plus hypnosis, hypnosis gives you a little extra bump. So we certainly recommend it. But by itself, it has an awful success rate. So always think hypnosis plus stuff. Thank you.
Great.
In your science, Changeology, do you address the aspect of depression that occurs when someone, you know, I was a smoker, when I stopped smoking, you get very depressed, or is there any room for that in your science?
You bet. Do you mean grieving the loss?
Yeah.
Yes. So every problem has a reinforcing property. That's why it stays there. I just mentioned this to the abnormal psychology students. They're not abnormal students, they were in the abnormal psychology class. Well, it could go either way, I wasn't sure. So Freud calls this the neurotic paradox. It's why do self-defeating behaviors occur? Because self-defeating behaviors are self-defeating in the long run. But virtually all problem behaviors are reinforcing, nurturing, yummy in the short run. Okay? So smoking, in the long run, we all know the health consequences, right? The monetary consequences, the early premature death, the preventable death. But in the short run, smoking is cool. And due to its calibrated drug release, it's safe, it's inexpensive, and it both relaxes you and improves your concentration. Virtually no other medication does it so quickly, so cheaply, and gets both concentration and relaxation. So in the long run, it's awful, but in the short run, it's wonderful, it's yummy, it's relaxing, it enhances how you can think. That's why it persists. So anytime you give up a behavior that is a problem, you are also losing something important. And that's the grief. So yes, in the book we talk about saying goodbye, writing letters to it. Sophisticated change, you're just not throwing something out. You're grieving something and trying to understand what it's doing. So once you're into that perspire stage, you're just not rooting out an old problem behavior, you are building in its healthy substitute. So for everyone who's stopping smoking, we're saying, how are you going to relax? Let's practice other ways of relaxing besides smoking. You need to put in a healthy substitute. And how are you going to think clear without the cigarettes? And incidentally, besides caffeine, there's not many good ways. So you're going to grieve that when you give up smoking. And as every psychologist knows, this is sad news, we are more controlled by short-term results than long-term results. We can keep thinking, I'll be healthier, I'll save money, I won't smell, but you know what? We are pretty much short-term creatures. So we tend to respond to what happens in the next 10 minutes. Okay. Those of you who are thinking, I could be doing work right now, that would be better right now, but I know you're sitting here because long-term, you're learning the success of how to change your behavior. But there's always this conflict between what's yummy in the short run and what is healthy. I'm sorry, yummy in the short run, right, and then healthy in the long run. You need to grieve when you give up a problem, including some significant others that I know you are dating and that I dated during college. We'll not go into that.
I read a book by Brian Kane, and he talks a lot about using mental imagery and self-talk to improve present focus and performance. Do you think those are tools that can also help with this?
It's not an opinion, it's an established fact, sir. There's hundreds and hundreds of studies on mental imagery. And you can use visual imagery, visualization techniques and the like, in two places. Once before you're ready to change, in which you imagine what the future is going to be, then you can also use it in Aspire once you've changed. So we call this the two-headed llama. And by the way, I just made this up for the book, but people think it was fabulous. It's been well established for decades, by the way, but I don't think anyone's ever called a two-headed llama. If you're as old as me, you may remember Dr. Doolittle's two-headed llama. Anybody remember that? Diego, yeah, only us over 40, okay. Maybe even older, but I won't say that out loud. So, Dr. Doolittle, played by Rex Harrison, has in his zoo a two-headed llama facing this way and that way. By the way, in the professional literature, this is called the Janusian dialectical. See how you just glazed over when I said that? That's why it's not in the book. What did he just say? Use those PhD words. Yes. Janusian is Janus, the Roman god, two-faced god looking forward and backwards. So the dialectic between the past and the future. So when you use imagery, we know it's more powerful that you imagine yourself in the positive future, how much better it's going to be, while simultaneously imagining yourself in the negative past. So some people say this is New York and this is California. The California New Age, just, oh, it's going to be beautiful once you get there, man. It's going to be beautiful. You should do that, but you should also be anchored on the East Coast with the New Yorker saying, it was really bad. You should have been here when it was really that bad. So your imagery is powerful when you do both. Take a moment, say, this is what it used to be, and that's awful. And so you marshal that energy that I don't want to be there. Simultaneously, look how much better it is when I change it. Established fact, not my opinion. Yes, sir.
Yes. How effective are the methods described in your book on things such as addictions that have a physical and a physical point?
So virtually all of our original research was on addictions. So this evening, I admit, look, our first three grants was on smoking and alcohol and the like. So not only is it effective, that's where it all began. It was my protest that this model only applies to addiction that led to the next 15 years of research, because I had to be convinced that this was not only about addictions. It's obviously a little more difficult, but the truth is, we now know from great, fascinating neuroscience research, is that every problem has a neurophysiological substrate, even if it's not ingested. But let's say gambling, so-called behavioral addictions, porn addiction, all those things, your body goes through a very similar withdrawal. So, while the ingestion of alcohol, meth, cocaine, smoking and the like is a little more difficult, all this applies to all those problems. Yes, we just can't leave our bodies aside. It may be a little more intense for some, but if you hook up people at gambling tables and then take them away, it's virtually identical to removal of caffeine, alcohol, illicit drugs and everything else. Yes, they literally start to tremor. It can, in fact, here at UConn did one of the original studies about 25 years ago. Yeah, very expensive to hook people up to all this stuff. Yes, sir.
You said if you are to succeed, you got to find multiple change catalysts and go through it.
You bet. So the secret sauce is on page. There it is. Okay. If anybody has the book, and by the way, this is the hardback cover. That's the softback cover. It's on page 37, The Change Catalyst. Now, be mindful, there are literally thousands of particular techniques to change behavior. Thousands. But that doesn't give you much direction. So we need to think more strategically in terms of principles of change, under which we can derive dozens and dozens of techniques for each. We call these change catalysts. So how we historically teach people to change, we now realize, is wrong. We either teach global theories, like psychoanalysis, behaviorism, systemic, family therapy, organizational change, or we teach very specific techniques. It turns out how self-changers, the most successful self-changers operate, and the most successful psychologists operate, is at a middle level of abstraction of principles or processes, We call these change catalysts. So there are, right here, these are the change catalysts. And then your creative part is to find particular techniques that work with you. So let's go through them. Tracking progress. Right? From the moment you think you have a problem you would like to change, all the way through persist, you're going to be tracking your behavior to see if there's slips, how you're doing, what triggers it, and the like. That's the change catalyst. How could you do that? Throw out some techniques. You asked the question, give me one. How do you track your behavior?
Jotting it down.
Jotting it down, there you go. A guy who likes to put things on calendars. Throw out some others.
Some people, when they're coming off of different addictions, they'll have like a calendar.
Exactly so. Called timeline follow back. That was the formal name for it. Other ways. We got no apps here? Nobody's on Fitbit?
I have Fitbit and also use my fitness planner, which helps with the calorie counting, etc.
There you go. My wife is trying to get me to use Atkins carbs counter. It turns out carbs do really well for me, but you can't go to a bakery when you're doing this kind of stuff. Journal. Some people like to journal. So if you're smoking, you keep little hash marks. Computer programs. All kinds of ways of tracking your behavior. Some people put them on calendars. Some people put them on their smartphones. The point is not the particular technique. It's you track your behavior. People who track their behavior do demonstrably better. Here's a nice example on weight. There's a national registry of weight loss. That is people who lost appreciable weight and kept it off now for at least 2 or 3 years. They continue to track their exercise, their calories, or their carbs, even though it's been 10 years. That's tracking progress. How do you decide which technique to use? That's largely what's available to you, what's convenient to you, what's inexpensive to you, and what works. That's part of your creativity and experimentation. But we know tracking progress works. That's the change catalyst. Here's another one, committing. Committing is a nice fancy word for saying willpower. Reminding yourself of what goes well, using models. We talked about use of imagery or visualization, talking to other people, reading inspiring stories. There are all dozens and dozens of techniques of how you can continue to commit. But remember, don't only use commitment. So the next two, raising awareness and arousing emotions, are only to be used getting ready in the early stages, right? Because what happens if you use them in the later stages? You fail, okay? So right, some things work for getting ready. Here it is, raising your awareness of the problem, of your defenses, and how to change. And then you need to arouse the emotions. We know information is not enough. Otherwise, I could cure everyone here of smoking. Smoking is bad for you. Don't do it. You're likely to die early. Okay, how many of those of you, did that help anyone? No, I don't think so. So it's information plus plus arousal. Okay? Not sexual arousal. Don't get excited that way. Get your emotions aroused. Motivate you. Okay? So it's always information plus arousal. So if you begin in the early stages of psych and prep to track your progress, to commit, raise your awareness of yourself, the problem, and how to change, and then truly get emotionally motivated for it, you are ready for perspire. And by the way, in the book, we have a checklist. You know, one of the advantages of doing this for 32 years and tens of thousands of research subjects, we know how much you have to do of each of these change catalysts to be ready. I mean, we literally have benchmarks or cutoffs in the book. They're also online if you want to pick them up there. When you do those change catalysts, you're ready for perspire to actually change your problem behavior. Then you stop arousing emotions and you use other things, like helping relationships. All right? So over here, give me some examples of techniques of getting people to help you. What could they do for you? You've all done this. And sometimes you've had helping relationships and you didn't want those helping relationships, but you got them anyway. What did people do for you to help you change and maintain that change?
Encourage, reward you, encourage you.
So we got verbal encouragements, they may actually reward you.
Lectures?
Lectures, and what did they lecture you about, sir?
Doing better in school.
There you go, but it's a reminder, isn't it? So they are in some ways tracking. Then they reward you when things go well, and they may even punish you when things don't go well. I prefer to call it a reminder. You know, we psychologists are not big on punishment, but a little punishment is okay to keep you on track. Love it. Other ways?
Keeping something away from you that you're trying to put in, you're trying to put something in, or trying to...
Everybody hear that? Right. So we call that environmental control. People, places, and things that tend to trigger. When we go out to dinner, my wife is very clear I'm responsible for my own behavior, but if she can stop that dessert cart from coming over, it is very helpful. For the proverbial, well, I'll just look. Maybe they'll have something that's healthy on the dessert cart. Now, that is a massive denial and rationalization, right? There is never anything healthy on a dessert tray, ever, in any decent restaurant in the world. So, she can help me by doing that. Right. She'll just say, no, we don't want to look at the dessert tray. Actually, I do want to look at the dessert tray, but she helps me that way. Other things they may do. They may periodically ask you how you're doing. They may identify small slips. Maybe you've given it up. When you just say, I've had enough, this is too difficult, I can't do it, they may be your support system to do all those things. So, it's up to you to decide who your helping relationships might consist of and what they do to some extent, but helping relationships predict quite well. Here's an example from our New Year's resolution studies. Helping relationships has no effect in the first couple weeks of January. People then can sort of willpower through it, go it alone, but once mid-January and March come, having a helping relationship almost doubles your eventual success. So use the buddy-up system. And this isn't just going to the gym, you can buddy up with people who aren't even trying to change. Okay. Buddy up system works.
Does that kind of fall along the same lines like an accountability partner? Somebody who just kind of keeps you accountable?
Exactly. And tracking progress does the same thing. And a good helping relationship is going to do most of the things we just talked about. They're going to track your progress, they're going to help you with your commitment, they're going to make you accountable. By the way, many people I've writing me have purchased the book after, or purchased additional copies and then given it to their helping relationship. We call it the Delta Team. It's got a nice armed force kind of thing, because this is a battle, by the way. All change is truly a battle inside of you and with your problem. So they give it to their Delta Team members so they know what they're trying to do. I never imagined they would do that, but anything that sells books is perfectly fine with me. What else are you doing? Rewarding. There's a change catalyst. You don't have to be B.F. Skinner to know that rewards make a difference. It's why you go to school. It's why you go to work. We hope it would all be intrinsic, but let's face it, we also respond to extrinsic rewards. Encouragements, actual rewards coming your way, better jobs, improved life, greater civic participation, all the things we expect, by the way, from a college education. Then I mentioned countering. Counter is doing the healthy opposite of the problem. Okay. So, what's the healthy opposite? Depression, what's the healthy opposite? People over here.
You're happy.
Right? So, improving mood.
Enthusiasm.
What else? Enthusiasm. When you get depressed, do you tend to go out more or less? Less. It's called depressive withdrawal. So the healthy opposite of that is called behavioral activation, a well-known therapy. Literally, you make people go out. The old theory used to be, well, wait till you're happy and then go out. This is terrible. We now know to prime the pump. Depressed people will say, I'll go out, but I won't have a good time. If you help them force themselves temporarily to go out, they will find they had a much better time they imagined. So it's the healthy opposite. What's a healthy opposite of sedentary lifestyle?
Exercise.
Boom. Everybody get that? What's a healthy opposite of eating off of the dessert cart?
No.
Not eating off, yes. Well, you can just reverse it. How about this? Eating more salad or eating a an appetizer that's far healthier, right? What's the healthy opposite of avoidance? Confrontation, but we psychologists call that exposure. You gradually make people go out and do it. Healthy opposite for anxiety is assertion, if it's social anxiety. Healthy opposite for stinking thinking is healthy thinking or imagery or visualization. There is a healthy opposite for everything. Overspending, it's called a budget. For being impulsive, taking drugs, overspending, well, then there's something called impulse control training. We literally train ourselves to think differently. There's a healthy opposite for every problem behavior. Unfortunately for smoking, we have lots of good ways of teaching people to relax. We don't have a good way of helping them increase their concentration besides substituting other drugs, which is what makes smoking notoriously difficult. So when you're sitting there kind of feeling both tired and I'm not concentrating too well, and nicotine can immediately improve that within 2 minutes, we don't have anything to replace that with other than caffeine, which is one drug for another drug, which is a little healthier, but not much. And I should mention, finally, we're in your list of change catalysts here, controlling the environment. So far, we talked about change as though it only happens between your ears. It's all about you. Guess what? We are mammals, sensitive to our environment. Some environmental conditions trigger good behaviors, and some not so healthy behaviors. So think in-laws. Think about bars. Think about desserts. Think about bakeries. Think about people who aren't exercising and you're trying to exercise. People, places, and things. Now the good news is, as humans, we are one of the few species that actively control our environment. So controlling your environment means putting people, places, and things into your life that will trigger healthy behavior. Think about some of your friends for a moment. You know if you hang out with some friends, you're going to engage in less than healthy behaviors. But other friends are more likely to coax, shape, and prompt better behavior. So reminders around the house, right? Little pigs on the refrigerator, little post-its on your bathroom mirror. All those things help you stay on track. And at least temporarily, you remove people, places, and things that will trigger the behavior. So just last week, I was seeing someone in recovery from multiple drug abuse. And he told me, because I asked, I said, by the way, do you happen to keep any alcohol around the house? He looked down for a minute and said, yeah, in case guests stop over, I always keep a couple six-packs. I looked at him and said, yeah, well, that's certainly a high-risk behavior. And he said, I know, I know. He says, but I like to have a little there. And I kept saying, yep, I get that. Sadly, that's going to be a trigger. He finally committed, got rid of it. By the way, at those moments, I always ask people in my office to call a spouse or significant other to help them do it, because that's part of the people, places, and things. Right? I'm not interested all that much in intentions. I'm interested in actual behavior. That's what gets things done. So remember, just not between your ears, just not internal of you, control your environment to help shape you. That was a long damn answer, guy.
Yeah, hi. I have two questions. One, the first one kind of builds off of where you just led us to, is how do you negotiate those external relationships where sometimes you can't escape and you can't cut them out? And I can think of that not only in terms of some of these addictions and things that people want to change, but also I think some of my first generation students coming to college is a change, not only for them, but for their families. So can you talk a little bit about how to negotiate some of those
rules? You bet, and that's managing slips. Because we don't control everything. There may be unhealthy work situations, school situations that just lead you into people, places, and things that are high risk situations. So whenever you can't modify those, then you're going to have to learn how to deal with those pressures. And that literally is what the chapter on persevere is about. There are always temptations everywhere. And if they're not physically present, you're carrying around them in your mind anyway. So how do you deal with such temptations? And there are, by the way, a handy list of 10 ways, but I'll hit several of them. First, distract yourself silly. Literally leave the situation. AA has this down. The moment you have an urge to drink or even take the first sip, you immediately leave the situation, you engage in hard work, get down on your hands and knees, do something, and call your sponsor. So distract yourself, immediately leave the situation if possible. If you can't physically leave the situation, then go to Disney World in your mind. Just because you're in that physical presence doesn't mean you're really listening. Once in a while, just to amuse my students, I say, right now, were you paying attention to me? Raise your hand. And usually I get about 60%. Okay? I was a student once too. Was I paying attention raptly every minute? Of course not. I was fantasizing, thinking, what's next? What am I having for lunch? This guy's a bore. Whatever, right? That just goes on all the time. So if you can't physically leave, you mentally leave. Next, it's called surf the urge. And this originally came out of the addictions research. So let's think you're at the beach for a moment and you're out in the water a bit. And a big wave comes. Just think about that for a moment, right? Big wave. How long does it take the wave to crest, go down, and end up at the shoreline? Say you're out 25 yards even. How long does it take? A couple seconds? Most a minute, even if you're at 50 yards? Okay. All right, now think of that big wave as a temptation, as a high-risk trigger. If, instead of fighting it, you can let it wash over you for a moment without responding to it, most high-risk triggers are literally gone within 2 minutes. Over 90%. We have good research on this now. So it's called surfing the urge. Think of an urge to do whatever. Not exercise, overeat, not study, whatever your goal may be. Think of that as a big wave coming in. You're just going to accept it for a moment, let it wash over you, and go to the shoreline. That is a skill we can all learn. And any of you regularly doing meditation have already learned that skill. You literally watch the content come in and go past. But instead of surfing the urge, what do most of us try to do, being Americans?
Fight it.
So, fascinating line of research in psychology. It's called the white bear experiment. Everybody ready for this? So you have to pay attention momentarily for this one, friends. All right, here we go. Whatever you do for the next 2 minutes, whatever you do, do not think of a white bear. Exactly. Okay? So that's like, here comes a high risk trigger or temptation, and you try to fight it. All right, I'm going to stand there, and I'm not going to take it. That wave, and it just knocks you on your butt. Okay? Now imagine, you just say, okay, I'll think of a white bear. The less you care about it, the quicker it goes away. That's called surfing the urge. There are moments to fight an urge, to distract, to leave, but when it's big and powerful, just let it wash over you, and within a minute, minute and a half, it's just literally gone. Of course, it also helps if you simultaneously then get out of the water, say, right? But you can learn this. It's a learnable skill. Don't fight it, just surf it. Let its power come and eventually just pass you. You can learn that in about an hour. Takes a little practice. You said there was a second one, sir?
Well, I was wondering as well how you might apply some of these to institutions or organizations. Some of these.
Yeah, that's a whole nother. I'm regularly talking to presidents of institutions and registrars and change agents and pharmaceutical companies and the like, because everybody moves through the same stages. But rather than having one stage, organizations and groups are at different stages of time. So we have several metrics for that. So let's say, what would be one that virtually everyone has done? Infusing diversity throughout the curriculum and in staff. Let's just take that one. A very popular goal for most institutions. If we do a stage of change for that, we just ask individuals, do you think this institution or this pharmaceutical company should infuse diversity by this? You will have some people who say, no, it's not needed here, pre-contemplation. You have some people say, that's a good idea, but I'm not quite sure, that's pretty scary, not sure what's going to happen. You're going to have some people who are already in action saying we should have been there a decade ago, and you're going to have other people who believe you've already successfully met it. So we have created benchmarks for knowing when to move. Because when you have a big group of students, or a big group of anyone working for an institution, literally people are not at the same stage at the same time. But using the same format, you can bring most people with you. As any administrator knows, I'm not sure you live, you're never going to bring everybody. You just bring enough to get the job done. The number one problem is even when it's done, it's maintenance. How do you continue to maintain the change? And that's where we say that's all about persevere and persist. You need to structurally put in reinforcements so it continues. You need public. There will be lapses. You need to do all that kind of stuff that we just talked about for maintenance. But this time you do it at a systemic level. Most people like to believe, well, actually the parallel is perfect. Most of you believe once you've met a goal, it will continue that way forever. I'm here to tell you that's delusional. The average person, for example, who stops smoking, how many times does it take someone to try to stop smoking, for at least a year? Take a guess. Yeah, but give me an average. 7 times is exactly right. 5 to 7 times. So how many times do we need to go through this to infuse, say, diversity into a campus or a pharmaceutical company? It may take several times. But if you follow the science, then you know what to do in maintenance to keep things going. But we like to believe it's just once. In truth, it's probably going to be many times. So what's the average number of times for someone who says, I'm going to start a diet on Monday and to keep that diet for at least a whole year? How many times do people go through that cycle? If smoking is 5 to 7. Every Monday, yes. So our research shows it's 3,492 times. Okay? Yes. I just made that number up. No one write that down, right? We had no idea. Okay? Because people have intentions, they do it for one day and give up. By the way, we suggest to everyone, never do that. If you are not ready for a change, be it on Monday, be it on New Year's Day, then wait when you are ready. There are certainly reasons, lots of social support, and most people are not working during the holidays, to begin on January 1st. But it's more important to be ready than to just wait for the calendar to tick off. Otherwise, what happens? You actually engage in self-defeating change, and then you realize you can't do it, and then one day in the future, sadly, you give up because you're convinced you're helpless. So wait till you're ready and do it. Yes, sir.
Yes, based on your science changeology book, how do you cope with people that are...
A little louder, how do you cope with...
Yeah, how do you cope with people that are doing bad things and they thinking that they are doing good things? For example, the ISIS group.
Well, the first law of psychotherapy and changeology, you don't change other people. So I have definitely avoided your question. This is all about what you voluntarily want to do for yourself. It is the inescapable law of behavior change. We do not change other people. And to do so is to beget frustration and accusations you're meddling in their life. What you can do is withdraw yourself if ultimately that's hurting you. So changeology does not address other people. Sorry.
I was wondering if you could elaborate a little bit on the science behind 90 days.
The science of 90 days?
Yeah.
You bet. Here you go. I will actually show you a figure, a representative figure as the undisputed authority on New Year's resolutions. You know, I honestly didn't know that was there, but now I like it so much. I'm going to keep saying it. Hey, I can't wait to go to a restaurant and say, do you know who I am? I'm the undisputed authority of Mayor's resolution.
Yes, the 300 articles is, you know, all the...
Well, that means, are you kidding? What's that mean to... That means nothing. So this is a true story, but I'm trying to find this page to show you. I was born into a political family. No worries. I did not choose to go that route, but one of my brothers is the honorable congressman from southern New Jersey. I won't tell you his party because I don't want to get half of you pissed off at me. So when occasionally I'm down there touring or doing something, my brother will introduce me to someone. And they'll say, it's nice to meet you, professor. And then they say, you may be aware of his research on New Year's resolutions. Suddenly, I'm someone important on Capitol Hill. Everybody wants to talk to me about their New Year's resolutions. But just a professor, so what? You wrote 20 books, we don't care. You got hundreds of publications, we don't care. You're just another someone. And can you even vote for me? No, okay, next person. You say New Year's resolutions? Everybody has a story about resolutions. Everybody. So now I'm not going to be able to find this in truth. But here's the short. How long does it take for you to change and maintain a problem behavior? As William James, the famous philosopher psychologist, says, you need to establish the grooves in your brain. Neuroscience has shown that to be true. If you can change your behavior and maintain it for 90 days, you are 90% confident that you have that forever. By the way, smoking, that's not true. You're only at about 60% of that. But you have it because you've gone from a short-term new behavior into a permanent habit. And that takes about 90 days. And I could show you lots of charts that if you get out, then it stabilizes. Your success is there at 90 days. So looking at the success of New Year's resolutions, because it's an easy example. 100% of people are successful for 1 hour. Yes, virtually everybody makes it 1 hour. In 2 weeks, January 15th, New Year's resolvers, you lost about 25%. At the end of 1 month, about 50%. So this is, you can just imagine the graph. So at the end of January, 50% are already out. If you get to the 3 months, which would be January, February, at the end of March, is that right? January, February, March, yes. Then you have a 90% chance of making it forever. Okay. It gets to about 40 to 46%, and then it just continues like that. So that's why it takes 9 months. Or, I'm sorry, 90 days. I'm trying to say 3 months because it sounds so much shorter. That's why it takes 3 months. Physiologically, something also occurs that every time you're responding to it, you're not responding to it as a threat or a loss, such as grieving it. There's even neurochemical changes that you now encounter this new behavior as something routine, right? So I'm sure if you literally looked at my neural activity with a functional MRI, when I'm flossing my teeth, I'm not anxious, I'm not fearful, I'm not debating, I'm not emotional. It's just something I do. But when I started doing that for the first time, I'm sure you saw lots of neural activity. So that's why both brain research and behavioral research says it's right about the 90 days. Now, you could fuss with me and say it's 80 days and maybe it's 100 days, but it's right about there.
And how long is it for smoking?
Smoking, because of its peculiar and wonderful neurochemical effects, if you get out to about 90 days without smoking, you have a 60% chance of never returning again. The truth is the other 40% are in what we call Obama land. He sneaks it on the side, he pretends he doesn't, then Michelle yells at him, then he insists he's quit again. So, yes. And that's just because of literally its unparalleled neurochemical. If anyone could ever design an addictive drug, it would be tobacco. Which is why tobacco, despite what most people think, is far more difficult to leave than alcohol, drugs, and the like. Yeah, so remember, what you're smoking is tobacco plus, right? This is not just off the farm in Virginia somewhere. They've added things that intentionally make it more difficult to stop, but also more pleasurable in the smoking experience. They want to keep the product going.
So what's the connection with the anti-smoking drugs, right? The Chantix and all of that. So they help you quit.
They are
suppress the thing in your brain if you want to smoke.
They fill the receptors And that's why they don't have as much side effects. So they're like the antidepressants that are the serotonin reuptake inhibitors. So they're reuptake inhibitor Shantex, so that you don't experience the same sort of pleasure and your euphoria. Yes. Shantex we thought would make a huge difference. It turns out it's a bit like hypnosis. It helps a bit. Same thing with nicotine replacement, you know, whether it's oral or gum or whatever. That also helps a bit. But it's such a recalcitrant problem that we suggest people do everything. Use nicotine replacement, use Chantix, use behavioral methods, use hypnosis. It really needs to be an aggressive multimodal approach. And that's now the American Lung Association approach as well. But the good news is, since we've been investigating and working with smoking cessation programs starting 32 years ago, we're from 40 or 50% of the population down to 18% last year. So we're gradually making progress. But we also suspect there are a lot of Obama cases. They say they don't smoke, but occasionally they do.
So I'm a sociologist, and I was wondering if you've done any research about social factors that relate to or help predict success, you know, social class or age, because it matters.
I wish we did, because you know, virtually every media journalist asks that question. Is it age? Is it gender? Is it ethnicity? No, no, and no. By the way, for those of us who are older, you would think we would be a little wiser and therefore better at this. No evidence for that. Largely because many of us just keep doing the same wrong things over and over again, not learning from trial and error. On the other hand, some people say it should be you youngins, because you have more energy, more enthusiasm, you believe you can do it, because right, you're immortal after all, so you think this is going to go on forever. No difference, not gender, not any of that. There are differentiations in terms of gender, in terms of what people want to change. Women, what do you all want to change? Yeah, right, body, right, body image and weight. That's an easy one. Men, relatively few of you want to do that. So men, more drinking, more smoking, women, more body image, exercise, weight management, and the like. But virtually nothing related to SES, ethnicity, race, age, any of those things. Wish there was, then we could do something about that. We got nothing. I think the natural energy is...
Okay, sure, I left it till 3:30.
If you have personal questions, not that I can render professional advice here in 5 minutes, I'd be happy to stay if there is something that you didn't want to publicly inquire about.
All right, well then let's thank Professor Norcross very much.
Thank you.